Good afternoon, members. We found the quorum is the appointed time. Thank you for attending the meeting. So can we first confirm the minutes of the meeting held on the 4th of May 2015? And that's paper number CB bracket 1025/1415. As of now, the Secretariat has not received any proposed amendments. Can we confirm the minutes of the meeting? Yes, please. Confirmed. Information papers issued since last meeting. There are several papers issued, including CB1942-1415-01 and also CB1945-1415-01. Can we invite the administration team in now, please? We would be moving on to the next item, design of new public rental housing flats, PRH flats. Several papers there, CB1-1037-1415-01 and bracket 02, and also CB1961-1415-01. And there is also a submission sent by a pressure group to members on housing issues. First of all, welcome to the government team. I won't introduce them one by one. The name list has been tabled. So can the administration briefly take us through your paper? You would like to use a PowerPoint, right? Ms. Fong, please. Thank you, Madam Chair. Let me walk you through the paper today, and that has to do with the design of the new public housing flats of the Hong Kong Housing Authority. For the past few decades, the Housing Authority has been adopting the standard block design, and since 2000, because of limited land resources and land plots are getting complicated in terms of their topography and so on, so we have switched to the site-specific design approach to more effectively use the land plots and maximize the potential of the land plots. There are non-modular flats, and the IFA is the one used for the New Harmony modular flats. And in 2006, we have new small flats design, 1 to 2P or 2 to 3P flats. And these new small flats design rationalized the ratio between kitchen and bathroom against living and sleeping areas and enhanced the natural lighting and ventilation. And in 2008, making reference to the experience of adopting non-standard flat design, HA developed a series of modular flat design, MFD, as a production strategy and covers also the 3P to 4P or 4 to 5P flats. And that is the strategy we adopted. And starting from October that year, HA has applied MFD to all domestic blocks in public housing development. And in response to the resumption of the construction of HOS, as announced in the 2011-12 policy address, and with HA's objective of providing quality homes, HA developed another line of MFD for HOS development in late 2011. MFD for the new HHS was mainly based on flat within IFA of about 35 square meters. Subsequently, HA standardized the IFA for this type of modular flats under both PRH and HOS developments. So these new MFD flats has been applied to all new public housing developments since mid-2012. For modular flat design, actually, there are now four types, including one or two-person flat with an IFA of 14.1 to 14.5 square meters. Second type, 21.4 to 20 square meters for two or three persons. And the third type, 30.2 to 31 square meters for three to four persons. And also 35 to 36.1 square meters for 4 to 5 persons. The spatial configuration has been, we have taken into account the flexibility of tenants in utilizing the living space to design the flat layout, size and dimensions, and the design also adopts standardized dimensions, spatial configuration and components, and compared with previous designs, it provides internal living space of better utility. All along, the design principle of public housing is meeting the basic needs of tenants with a simple and environmentally friendly approach. Except for the tiled wall floor in both the kitchen and the bathroom, there is no other partitioning and floor finish. In a modular flat, tenants can decide on internal partitioning and furniture layout. In terms of overall design, the ratio between kitchen and bathroom against living and sleeping areas is rationalized to cater for various family combinations, to allow flexibility for partitioning and placing of furniture, and cross-ventilating windows are provided to enhance natural lighting and natural ventilation and lighting. The design menu barrier-free access 2008 is applicable, and the width of the door has been increased from 750 to 800 millimeters and provides a sunken shower area and installs power sockets at 1 meter above floor level. Now, after 2003, after the SARS scare, a deep re-entrant of a building envelope could create inadequate ventilation was found. Hence, the ratio of width to depth of the re-entrant areas is maintained at 1 to 3 or below. And also, the W-trap system is installed in all domestic flats to ensure that the water traps will not dry up. In terms of the detailed design, the electric co-consumer unit is installed at the living area for convenient use and maintenance. And more twin sockets are provided inside the flats in response to tenants' demand. Water traps and shower head with WSD's water efficiency labeling are provided to reduce water consumption. Synthetic resin kitchen countertop is provided. Tenants can make requests for adjusting its height to cater for their needs after moving in. Wastage arising from disposal of unwanted fittings could be avoided. And laundry rack is provided at the external facade for better exposure to sunlight. And overhang is provided to avoid nuisance from water dripping. In 2015, XJ has enhanced MFD to enhance the design, and we are using more precast components, volumetric precast components, wider application of mechanized construction technology and precast of parts and components. The quality, cost effectiveness, construction efficiency and productivity have been further improved. For public housing, which is exposed to noise nuisance, we have adopted various measures. For example, in 2013, for Wing Chung Estate, we have noise abatement design for the estate to cut the decibel from 2 to 6 decibels. We also put a lot of emphasis on the environmental protection. We would try to adopt the best configuration. We would like to make use of natural lighting and ventilation and reduce on energy consumption. We want to provide a comfortable living environment and build a sustainable community. Since 2008, we've adopted a twin water tank design, which secures an uninterrupted supply of water and reduces water consumption from cleansing the water tank. We install grid-connected photovoltaic system at the upper roof to generate electricity and harvest rainwater for irrigation with a view to saving water. In 2010, or starting from 2010, for all new development planned, we provide an overall greening ratio of at least 30% for sites over 2 hectares and at least 20% for sites below 2 hectares. It will help mitigate urban heat island effect and improve air quality. As a result, tenants can enjoy a healthier living environment. Way forward. MFD enhances the flexibility and quality of living space and has been generally supported by PRH tenants. In accordance with the resident survey, satisfaction index conducted in 2013-14, the satisfaction index is about 95%. And in early 2014, the satisfaction rating for newly completed estate can reach as high as 98%. And this demonstrates that our tenants are generally satisfied with the overall planning design of the estates and the individual flats. It will continue to collect tenants' feedback through resident surveys and take on board views from the stakeholders in the construction industry in relation to design and construction of public housing in order to pursue continuous improvement of MFD. While meeting the production target, it will also put emphasis on harmonizing the public housing developments and the environment with due regard to social, economic and environmental needs, as well as planning and related legal requirements. Thank you, Chairman. I'll now hand over the floor to members for asking questions. I'll read out the names. Wong Kwok Hing, Kwok Wai Kong, Frederick Fung, Lee Chuk Yen, Raymond Wong, Leung Yu Chung, Leung Chi Cheng, and Leung Kwok Hung. 4 minutes, including answers and questions. Mr. Yip Kwok Hing, Mr. Wong Kwok Hing.
Thank you, Chairman. Regarding PRH design, of course, I'm aware that the department is continuously improving design, and I have 5 suggestions to share with the department, and I would like them to respond. First, partitioning. We are aware that some partitioning are not reasonable. For example, I have complaints from Taiwan where the bathroom and the lounge area is a significant difference. They're not uniform. For example, they had to accommodate the site and change the design. Sometimes the bathroom is too large and the lounge is too small. So for 2-3 people apartments, it is not possible to accommodate 3 people. That's the first point. The second point is the water department is suggesting that we save water. But in estates, when you want to install the water-saving component, it cannot be installed. And we hope that the department can learn from this experience. So in new estate designs, they need to be able to accommodate the water-saving taps and pipes. The government also needs to accommodate for hot and cold water taps. In our current design, we had a press conference where it is hard to use hot water taps, especially children and the elderly. They are burnt by the hot water. The second point is about the metal gates. In the past, we had accordion-style gates, which were very annoying. It created a lot of noise. It would wake up a lot of people. So these accordion-type gates, these should be made obsolete. And the last point, we hope that the government, when doing design, they need to force see the tenants when they age, the bathrooms or corridors. They need to install some handles to prevent slipping and falling, especially the elderly. Therefore, in the bathrooms or lounge, in suitable locations, they should set aside space or have a design where handles can be installed. So 5 suggestions. I hope the department can respond. Thank you, Mr. Wong Kok-shing, for your suggestions. You mentioned a lot of details. These are not applicable in the new modular design, but we will take on board your views. And regarding the metal gates, in the new generation gates, they are not using the accordion style gates. And you also mentioned whether space could be set aside for handles. Yes, we can consider that in our future design. Well, thank you for the positive response. I'd like to say that the taps, a lot of new flats cannot catch up with development. Recently, the water department has called for saving water, and they hand out these taps for free, but they cannot be installed. We have actually met with the water services department, so we hope in the new designs you have to consider this as well. Yes, we will look at which components can be installed. Just now you mentioned the Taiwan estate. That was the previous design. It's not the current design. Next, Mr. Kok Wai Kong, and then Fong Kim Kei. Now, just now, the government, the housing authority had mentioned the current designs have improvements, but as a matter of fact, for the residents, they feel living area is important. So I have a few questions. First of all, for two-bedroom flats, they are smaller by some 10%. So is it the understanding that you want to increase housing supply and therefore livability or large family living area is sacrificed? That's the first question. Second, the paper talks about site-specific planning. Do you comply with certain conditions and therefore current estates will have to use smaller modular components? In the future, will we have new sites where they can use the old design? That's the second question. The third question, well, we cannot rule out that what has happened in Bak Tin Estate. A lot of the tenants there mentioned that for the people who moved into Sekip Mei Estate, they are using the old design. The two-bedroom apartments are larger. It can go up to some 41 square meters. But in phase two, those resituated in situ, they have only some 26 to 30 square meters. So why do we have two different treatments? Why did the housing authority pledge where in situ relocation, why do they have different treatments? They want a reasonable response. Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Chairman. Our design principles was a per capita area not less than 7 square meters. So using the site-specific principle, we want to have a per capita living space that is reasonable. So after rationalizing the bathroom, the lounge, and living space to accommodate different family needs, we want to have ventilation and lighting to comply with modern standards. So under these design principles, we want to stick to the per capita living space of not less than 7 square meters. So that's why we're using the modular design, and we're using these standards. So in the diagram I showed you just now, we have the size per flat for 1 to 2 persons. It's about 14 square meters. It's 21 square meters for 2 to 3 people. For 3 to 4 people, it's between 30-31 square meters, and 35-36 square meters for 4 people or more. Well, could you answer the question? Are you trying to meet the quota? And for Bak Tin Phase 1, Phase 2, is it unjust because of different treatment? Well, for each generation of design, we had to comply with the standards. Now, if you look at Bak Tin Estate, the first batch who moved to Phase 2, Phase 5 in Bak Tin Estate, that was a design prior to 2005. Now, as time moved on, we are now using the current combination. Well, we had two direct questions just now. First of all, is it unjust treatment for the same tenants in the same estate? And second question was, are you trying to catch up with some quotas? Well, there's no separate treatment. When they move to a new estate, the time is different. And at different times, we build different buildings, the size, would be similar to their original housing size, so there's no unjust treatment. And when we resituate, there's some flexibility. We have 3 to 4 people unit, 4 to 5 people unit. So 4 or 5 people, families might be designated a 3-4 person unit. If they need a larger unit, they might be relocated to different districts or different estates. Mr. Kwok had 2 questions, and allow me to respond. Just now, Ada had referred to the historical background of the modular design, and there are changes in the design. If you just look at the size, when did we have the 4-bedroom unit? When did the size change from 41 square meters? Well, it started to decrease from 2008 and even decreased in 2012. If you recall 2008 and 2012, we were building 15,000 PRH. We didn't have HOS. We didn't have these long-term targets. So I can tell you directly that it's not related to fulfilling quotas. And when we relocate tenants, we have some 730,000 units, and they are built over different times. So when families are relocated, it depends on what is available. So every day, they might be, and at any point in time, they might be given a larger unit. But if they are relocated now, they might be given a smaller unit, but they would have a more modern facilities. We have some 700,000 units. I would like you to understand that we are working within these constraints. Phong Kim Kay. Well, I think the housing department, they are going in opposite directions to what Mr. C.Y. Leung said 2 years ago, because Mr. C.Y. Leung said that Hong Kong people need to live in a bigger space. He stated that very clearly. You are aware that in Singapore, it's smaller than Hong Kong. Of course, they have a smaller population, but if you look at per capita living area, per person, they have some 300 square feet. Hong Kong only has 150 square feet per person. We have less than half their living space. If we want to follow the direction of Mr. C.Y. Leung, should we move ahead of Singapore, or do we want to move behind Singapore? And in paragraph 2, you say that there were land constraints, and by 2008, designs have changed. But I have some diagrams for you. This is from Bak Tin Estate. So the diagram tells you that in 2008 and in 2012, when they rebuilt phase 1, phase 2, 1 to 2 person, 3 to 4 person units had not changed. The largest change was in 2-bedroom units. So I've met with the housing department staff, and at the time you said that a 2-bedroom unit was a new design. We had you had old Harmony designs. Now we're talking about 2012, 12 years after 2000. So the new Harmony design and the modular design could be combined, such that 2-bedroom unit were larger. Referring to the document, it says 438 square feet to 441 square feet. In the new Bak Tin redevelopment, these are the same tenants in the same district. When they were relocated to Sekit Mei Phase 2, Phase 5 for 1-bedroom, you use the new, use the old design, and for 2-bedroom you use the new design, and on this occasion of redevelopment you are using the new design. So we have the situation where in the same district, in the same phase of redevelopment, it's just because you did not divide into 2 phases, so those who moved first seemed to have an advantage, and those who moved later had a disadvantage. So the first question is, why could you take the Sekit Mei Phase 2, Phase 5, why could you come up with a combined design and a blueprint? And now in Bak Tin Phase 2 redevelopment, why can't you use the similar approach? And third, the basic question is, why is the direction you're taking opposite to what Mr. C.Y. Leung proposed? allow me to respond. Ada can add and implement, can supplement later. Mr. Feng Gimge referred to Baktin redevelopment history. Well, for a large project such as Baktin, they would need a longer time. You cannot do it in one phase. You might need two or more phases. So over such a long period, for the modular design, we had always wanted to learn from experience and improve. So if you relocate at different phases, we would have a different module designs, so there would be some differences. We have types 1, 2, 3, 4. Some might be smaller, but they would have a higher ceiling. They might have a better window design. So that is a fact. Regarding your earlier questions, regarding the size, the CE ideas, we are aware of that, but in our ledge code discussions, in the question and answer, or in the motion debate, we have, because of time constraints, I won't repeat, but we have explained to you what we can do given the size.
All right,
thank you. I still have some questions. Can you allow the Mr. Ying or Ms. Feng to answer the questions? And also, I have a suggestion. Can we try to lengthen the bedrooms a bit for the two-bedroom units, and then that can help fix the problem? Please be brief in your answer. We are adopting the same design for new flats to be built, and it's difficult for us to make any changes now. Now, for Shekit Mei phases 2 and 5, we are using the 2006 design. And the smaller units were actually adopting the design or the parameters of the harmony design, and now it's been changed altogether. Next one, Mr. Li Chuk-yen. The permanent secretary was trying to say that the CY Lan was talking about nonsense and he was lying, and after he told lies, then, of course, the measures could not be implemented, and you had to explain yourself. And that goes to show that the CY Lan was actually telling lies. A very practical question here. You said that for the MMF design, different approaches may be adopted for different public housing estates, but for Paktin estate residents in particular, actually, the size of their units is smaller by 50 square feet. But your explanation is that this has to do with the new design, MFD, so as long as we can achieve the target of 7 square meters per person, it's okay. But then for the residents, they think it's grossly unfair. How come that I allocated a new flat later, but then my flat is smaller? You failed to come up with a good explanation. You explained that you're not trying to catch up with the quota, but what's the point of having this design? And actually, it's a retrogression to the residents because the size of the units is smaller. Why can't you do a better job here? How come that the society is backpedaling and not making progress? And you didn't come up with a good enough explanation. Now, if it is the case that you want to build more units and having smaller sized units, then, well, just to say so. But you said that this is not the case. So why? Why are we having smaller units? So two questions. Does it mean that CY Lan was lying and he was making things difficult for you? And second, why are you downsizing the units? Permanent Secretary, with regard to the MFD and the changes all along, we have set out in our paper, and also as Ada explained, why we are making changes to the MFD. We want to learn from experience and improve on the design. Well, there are many factors affecting whether people think that their living environment is comfortable. In recent years, we attach a lot of importance to lighting and air ventilation, and in new units, we've got cross-ventilating windows. We also adopt modern designs for the environment, 30% greening, open space, and so on. So we hope that the residents can appreciate all these. Apart from looking at the size of their flats, they should also attach importance to other factors. We're trying to make their living environment for more comfortable. Among the 700,000 units, actually the sizes differ. It's not just unique in Pakteen. For example, Shouchun O Estate, 4 to 5P units. It's around 37 square meters. And now compared to 41 square meters in the old, some existing flats, it's smaller. But then for Shouchun O, there have been improvements in other aspects. And it's a more comfortable living environment. In the future, we would be collecting views from residents and try to make further improvements on the MFD. Mr. Raymond Wong, followed by Mr. Leung Yu-chung. Mr. Raymond Wong? Sorry. Of course, I have something to say. With regard to site-specific design, I would like to ask, why don't you improve your design based on the needs of the times and based on people's needs? Why do you have to be using site-specific design? All right, my first question. You said that because of the topography, size, and configuration of the sites are complicated. So starting from 2000, it has adopted this site-specific design. When I read the housing department's papers, I think they're trying to use a beautiful language and so on. They've come up with all sorts of terms for the different programs. Now they are having this site-specific design, this particular term. Well, people are not important. Land is important. We haven't enough land plots. And actually, you are reducing the size of the flats, and you call it as a site-specific design. And you are saying that this is all for the good of the residents. And you said that it will be helping to optimize the site development potentials. Well, admit it, if you haven't got enough land, just to say it outright that you haven't got enough land. Don't try to use such terms to muddle things through. C.Y. Leung was also very good at practicing sophistry, and we should not believe in C.Y. Leung. Well, I don't think we should believe in what is set out in the paper. Site-specific design, and that is really in response to the site constraints and so on for redevelopment of public housing estates. We used to have standard block design, and that can still be applied. I think the both types of design can coexist together. Why do we have to sticking to one design only? For some size, you don't have to adopt the site-specific design. If you do that, you would only prolong the construction period, and the costs will also go up, and the housing resources will be squandered too. The Housing Authority has, in recent past, been asking for establishment of new posts. I think that has to do with this as well. Isn't it money? It costs to us. So I think you must give us good justifications on why you cease adopting the standard block design. You must convince us. I think you are trying to boot those things through. You said that you would like to adopt a functional and cost-effective approach. Well, I get very angry when I read terms like those. What you are actually doing is downsizing the unit. And you don't have actually fitting out works for the flats. And for people moving into the new flats, they have to spend a lot in fitting out the flats themselves. No partitioning, no floor grid and so on, and you are trying to say that this is functional and cost-effective, environmentally friendly, and it is there to meet the basic needs of the residents. Well, on the surface of it, it seems that you are doing good, but actually, this is not the case. You have to spend, say, well, $100,000 to fit out the flats yourself when you move in. So, time's up. We've got a number of items today. So your time's up. Well, you've made your point already. Next one, Mr. Leung Yu-chong, followed by Mr. Leung Chi-chung. Madam Chair, the Housing Authority's colleagues have used very good terminology to explain why the size of the flat has got smaller. Well, it's an undeniable fact that the unit size is reduced. You said that you have taken drawn reference from experience and you've listened to residents' views. But then the residents' views are that the size of the unit is getting smaller and they want the unit size to be enlarged or increased. You said that you try to learn from experience, you try to improve the living environment. But in the 10-year long-term housing plan, you set this. You said that you are concerned about the living space per person. You are being treacherous. You didn't say large or small units will be provided. You said that you are concerned about the living space. Well, if that is the case, why is it that you are reducing the size of the unit and not increasing it? PIH tenants have been saying that their living environment is very congested. How much of their views have you taken on board? Have you listened to views that the residents would like to have a larger flat? If you have listened to it, what have you done to respond to such views? Director or PS? Residents, of course, have a lot of views on PRH units, new and old. We try to incorporate or take heed on board their views as much as we can. It's not the case that we can respond to each and every of their demands. We do have our own strategy on how to allocate our flats, how to build our flats. You are shying away from the important issues. In the past, we used to have 16.5 square meters for one person, and the resident said that, well, it's too small. Well, actually, I went down and visited such flats. You can accommodate only one bed and one cabinet. And now you are proposing 14 square meters. I don't think you are being responsible. You are listening to views selectively, and you've been turning a deaf ear to the residents' comments. Would you call that really being accountable to public views? My question is, how come that you are downsizing the flats and not increasing their sizes? As I said, we have listened to many views, and if we can, we'll try to respond to residents' suggestions. And the HA has drawn up a policy on constructing and allocating the flats. And for the policy is that one person will enjoy a living space of not less than 6-7 square meters. For the four types of units, 1 to 2 persons, 2 to 3 persons, etc., depending on the resource availability, we do have flexibility in allocation. If there are two persons applying for a flat, should we be allocating them 1 to 2 person units or 2 to 3 persons? If resources permit, we will allocate them 2 to 3 persons units to them. But then it really boils down to the resource availability. You don't have many 3-4 persons flats. I think you are trying to cheat the public here. Well, there are quite a number of agenda items here today. I hope that as many members can speak as as possible. Now, we'll have a Leung Chi Cheng, Leung Kwok Hong Yip Kwok Hi Mui Chi Cheng. And second round is Lee Chek Yen and Frederick Funk. Mr. Leung Chi Cheng, followed by another member. Recently, I bumped into a resident. He said that he's waiting for a four-person unit. And it seems that the queue hasn't moved a bit. I'm sure that he has checked that this is the case before he said so. Many members asked why you are building smaller units these days, and the director, your response is that you are adopting site-specific design. There are so many people on the waiting list. Now, if the units are smaller, then you can build more flats. But then the four-person applicants are still waiting for a long time. Please tell us whether the queue hasn't moved a bit. If you are downsizing the units and increase the number of units to be provided, then that can be a short-term solution. But don't tell us that this is a long-term solution to the housing issue. Well, the residents will get angry because of this. Well, I've served as a district councillor for many years, and many people have come and approached me and asking us to help them to relocate the flats to a larger flat.
They need a bigger unit. They don't want a smaller unit. So the LegCo had a debate once on living space, how we can enhance our living space. But the government is now decreasing living space, and I'm very disappointed. The housing department, you need to explain, is this a long-term policy? And in the future, will all public PRH get smaller and smaller? Of course, your design is trying to satisfy the utility needs, the kitchen, the bathrooms, or even the windows are being redesigned. But I have received some tenant complaints that the walls, it's very difficult to hammer a nail. All the walls are hollow, aside from poor soundproofing. Even if you want to hang something, it's very difficult. So can you improve that? A director or assistant director? Let me respond to the question about hanging stuff. You referred to the waiting time, the queues. It should be moving along. But in 2014-15, our new buildings, we didn't have a lot of increase, including our units that were resumed. We have some 10,000-odd tenants that can be relocated. We might have some 30,000 this year. So we hope that for individuals in the queue, they can get accommodated. Well, the housing department has an annual plan for overcrowded tenants. If the average is less than 7 square meters, well, Director, my question was, these small standards, is that a long-term policy? That's the thrust of my question. Could you respond? Well, I'm not sure what you mean by long-term. The current policy is that not less than 7 square meters. If it's less than 7 meters, we have an overcrowding scheme where they can relocate to a larger unit. Next, we have Mr. Leung Kok-hong. Just now, Mr. Wong Yuk-man was talking and to summarize, all the dirt is just being swept under the carpet. our officials move from post to post. Now, if Mr. CY Leung were to live up to his pledges, well, he visits estates all the time. He would have heard that it's overcrowded, my unit is small and smaller. If Zheng Huafeng were to live in a PRH, he couldn't even fit into the washroom. He couldn't even squeeze his belly through the door. Well, he's always saying that he needs only a pencil, a notepad, and a table. Now, let me tell you. The wise people in the past had said that we just need an elegant space. But now our officials are talking about different designs, elegant designs. I'm patriotic. I'm a patriotic poet. And let me recite some poetry. It's Mr. Dufu. So, it means that the house was flooded, and he's very sad, and he sees if other people are accommodated, have a housing. Mr. Tufu had a grass cottage, so the CE, your conditions are much better than Tufu, and you're now asking the officials to come up with schemes, for example, the site-specific designs. You're now giving people smaller and smaller living space. Your reform is causing more pain, so why do you bother reform? You shouldn't be doing that. My stance is very simple. Any reform is necessary, and the reform is an improvement. So I don't need you to respond. I just give you a quote from Mr. Mao Zedong. Mr. Mao said that we should improve every day. But now our situation is deteriorating, and the government is talking, but the government is talking about good news every day. So are you taking the Hong Kong public to be your enemy? Where the public, they're in a more and more desperate plight by the day. Well, Chairman, I know you're an English major. You can, but now think in Chinese. This is ridiculous. Why do you have a reform where the situation deteriorates, and the people are telling you not to reform? Why are you reforming, Mr. Ying, Mr. San Ying? Are you reforming just for reform's sake, or are you reforming for improvement? We now have complaints. If you go to the Bak Tin estate, I invite Mr. CY Leung to Bak Tin. If he receives applause, I'll do anything. Next, Mr. Yip Kok Him, and then Wu Jiwai. Thank you, Chairman. As a matter of fact, PRH is a beneficial policy. It gives good living conditions to those in need. Now, if they have larger space, of course it would be more popular, but we do need to balance the different factors. I am a member of the subsidized housing under the Housing Authority. I'm also a member of the construction group, and I see that the PRH now, compared to the past, there is a very significant improvement, not just the units itself, it's the facilities, it's the estate grounds. So you shouldn't just look at the smaller unit. Of course, can we balance it out with other measures? That is something that should be considered. I think society also needs to strike a balance. those not in PRH, those in private housing, they also have views. They also want to move into PRH. Of course, there would be less complaints if the living space were increased. So how do we strike a balance? I feel that the public or legislators should have their own views regarding Bakhtin Estate. Will phase one, phase two exist differences? Just now, the government had already responded. My question is first of all, our standard now is each per capita living space should be not less than 7 square meters, but for 4 or 5 people, families, but what about families of more than 5 people? So in Bakhtin Estate or other PRH, is there no arrangement for them? Though there are some 6 people or 7 people families. So how will you handle these families? Another question is, currently, given this design, the aircon facades, if you partition the lounge into bedroom, they can't install aircons. So can you offer drainage and so on, and in electricity supply? In the old PRH, they couldn't supply enough electricity. So can we provide these basic amenities? Thank you, Chairman. Well, Chairman, if the family has 6 or more members, we only have 4 standard sizes currently. If we encounter 6 families, we will, a 6-person families, we will give them 2 units. So we have families with more than 6 members, but not a lot. We will give them 2 units if resources allow. This is a better arrangement. So we have flexibility in this regard. Regarding the aircon question, I defer to Ada. Regarding the aircon platforms in the new PRH, they can install aircons. If they need an extra partition, they can install an extra aircon. Mr. Wu Jiwai, Chairman, I'm aware that in the new designs, 1-2 person, 3-4 person, 2-3 person, their average area is about 10 square meters. But for 4 or 5 person families, their living space is reduced. It's 8.75 to 9.25 square meters. So 4 person families, the average living area is smaller than 1-2 person, 2-3 person families. What is the rationale? So assuming you want to save space, so if you use Bakhtin Estate as an example, is it because when you save space, you can build more units? And is it because of this, you have some unused plot ratio? Third question, by reducing the living space, does it save construction costs? If you save construction costs, how much is saved? Could you respond to these 3 technical questions? If not, whether it is Bakhtin Estate or other estate tenants, if you do something that is of no help, no assistance, if you use the plot ratio, if you increase the number of units, so whether they are in the waiting list or they are tenants, if they have to face a smaller area, then this is unjust. Mr. Wu has 3 questions. I couldn't follow up with the numbers. He asked us that by adopting the new modular design, how many units are increased? How much money can we save? Well, it depends on how you compare with the different designs. you need to compare like with like. If I refer to the documents compiled by my colleagues, the different factors were considered and different designs were proposed. So I have never seen that we will have an increase in the number of units or saving cost savings. Well, so if you want to do this kind of comparison, let's say if you're comparing Wafu estate, four-person unit, Chairman, we don't need to argue. I'm just asking that we're talking about new design versus the old Harmony design. There's just one small difference. So I want to ask, when we do something, there has to be an advantage or a benefit. One, you can build more units, or you're able to utilize the plot ratio, or have you saved a lot of construction costs. Otherwise, if there is no contribution to these factors, what's the point?
Director, I'm not here to argue with the member. I'm trying to lay out the facts for reference by the member. I was just trying to quote from past HA papers. They never said that they would like to save costs. I've never seen figures in that respect. If you just look at the size of the flat, that won't be good enough. So can the director tell us why the four-person flats are smaller? Well, you just do a division. Now, 1 to 2P flat, 14.1, 14.5 square meters. 2 to 3P flat, 21 to 22, 3, 4P flat, 30 to 31. But for the four-person flats, the average living space per person is smaller. So if you look at the four, five-person flats, 35 to 36 square meters, around 7 to 8 per person, and 3, 4P flats, around 7 square meters. I think your figures are wrong. Well, that doesn't matter. Next one, Mr. Tony Chair. Thank you, Madam Chair. Well, everyone wants to live in a larger flat. When I assumed the electrical office, the first motion that I moved was about improving the living space for people. And regrettably, not everyone in the Legislative Council supported my motion. We should have an objective in housing production for PRH. We have a yardstick, and which is 7 square meters, and also IFA. For private housing, we don't have such yardsticks. Say, if you have $3 million in the past, you could have a flat of 300 square feet, but now you can only end up with a 200 square feet flat. So for PRH tenants, they may be living in relatively larger space compared to the standard. We may have some amendments now. The area has been cut. But I think we can consider whether there are improvements in other aspects. The government official just now said that there will be a higher ceiling, there will be cross-ventilating windows, and also the flat can be put to better use because of its configuration. Now, in the construction industry, we would look at the usable area of a flat. For 1 to 2P flats, if it is just there is just one person, and if you've got an IFA of 14.1 square meters, that's a very good size. But of course, we don't have enough resources, and that's quite understandable. And we want people to support the government's initiative in identifying more land for building residential housing. Now, Madam Chair, there are four types under the MFD. What is the ratio of these four different types in PRH? And what is the basis for their consideration? Say, if there is a greater demand for 1 to 2P flats, you may build more such flats. Please consider that there will not be any mismatch of the in allocation, or else you will be treating people unfairly. Now, say if two persons live in a 2-3P flat and you're reallocating them to a 1-2P flat, and they would be unhappy, of course, because they used to live in a flat which is above the usual standard. So they won't like to be relocated to a smaller flat. Who to take that question? The members, your last question. We have four types of housing under MFD. What is the ratio of the four different types? So we don't have anything set in stone. It's difficult to quantify that. For those on the waiting list, we're not satisfying their needs only by new flats. We will be allocating recovered flats to them as well. So there are different types of flats to be allocated. So we will be focusing more on 2-3P flats. Statistics-wise, there are more applicants who are 2-3P flat applicants. Mr. Kwok Wai Kang, 2 minutes each. Thank you, Madam Chair. The administration emphasized that the design, the new design is better. Well, I believe that you haven't actually lived in such a flat. Now, from an administrative point of view, we're talking about 7 square meters for one person. So you will not, you will still be up to the standard with your new design if that is the standard to be taken. The director said that policies change over time. But then the timeline for making changes for within the period between the redevelopment of phase 1 and phase 2 of Pakatin Estate, if that is not the case, then you will be adopting the same design or standards for both phases 1 and 2 of Pakatin. But this is not the case. And some residents are unhappy. They come to the complaints division of the Legco, and some are protesting outside the construction sites. So can the administration take a more people-oriented approach? The director said that two flats will be allocated to 6P applicants. Now, if there are two bedrooms for a six-person applicant, then that won't be good enough because some of them may have to sleep in the living room. So if there are five-person applicants, can you also allocate two flats or two units to them? Director, in allocation of flats, the same set of standards will apply to those being reallocated flats or those on the waiting list waiting for new flats. For 6P applicants, we'll try to give them two flats. But then if they are 5P applicants, we would first offer them 4-5P flats. So that applies to both those being relocated and also new applicants. Mr. Frederick Fung, can I be given two pieces of information? In the past decade, what is the average living space allocated per person? 7 square meters was drawn up some 30 years ago. The standard has not changed in the past 30 years. In the past, it used to be 11 square meters, and that has been cut to 7 square meters now. And you are drawing your building plans based on that. You are getting more stringent in your standards. Also, Director, you said that the redevelopment plans should be tailor-made. So why are you mixing up the redevelopment plans together with the plans for the new applicants? You can exercise your discretion to do that, of course, but then you're adopting the same standard for both types of residents. Well, in the past 10 years, there were relatively few redevelopment projects. Well, look at how reallocation was done in the past. There are now 21 housing estates which are going to be redeveloped. So you should adopt a tailor-made approach. So the new housing or the redeveloped estates should be tailor-made for the needs of those affected. Now, for the 5P flats, 4 to 5 persons may share the same toilet, the same living room, and there may be conflicts among different members of the family. And also for the 2-bedroom flats, the space per person is getting smaller. So, Director, can you provide the information later on? Mr. Frederick Fung referred to 22 housing estates. Well, our view on redevelopment has changed, and it's set out in the paper on the long-term housing strategy. Now, for those affected by redevelopment, they're given priority in flat allocation. So they will be given the chance to choose the flats in the redeveloped housing estates. Now, for 1-2P flats, I can allocate it to one person. And for 2-3P flats, I can allocate it to a two-person household. So they are given that kind of arrangement. I can provide the other information requested by Mr. Fung later. It's my turn now. The director and also the deputy director said that they will exercise flexibility and discretion in allocation of flats. You said that there is this under-occupied flats. And they may become under-occupied flats because some elderly may have passed away. For those affected by redevelopment, well, they actually may have to be asked to relocate because they have become under-occupied units, households, a few years down the road because the elderly have passed away. So, Director, do you have any solutions to help those affected by the redevelopment of packed in estate? You said that you adopted the modular flat before 2012, and you are not doing it just because you want to fulfill the quota. So is there any way that you can come up with sort of measures to help packed-in estates? Mr. Wong Kwok-hing talked about water traps, gates issues, and also hammers on walls and so on. These are very specific issues raised by members. So after the meeting, Deputy Director, can you respond to these points on the interior fitting of PRH units? Three questions, Director, about under-occupied households. I think we have deliberated on this in the panel before. For those aged over 60, And also for households with people who don't have good physical mobility, we won't allow them, we won't ask them to relocate. Now, as to what we can do to help Pakting residents, I hope that you can understand that for this redevelopment project, we hope to improve their living environment. Please understand that for the interior fitting of the PRH units in terms of ventilation, lighting, and so on, we've done a lot. We will be doing a lot of improvement, and the overall environment will be substantially improved. As to the size of the unit, well, it's the same as that in Suichino Estate, and people are happy to move in there. So there will definitely be improvements in the quality of living after they've moved in. Before residents move in, we also set up a set out the actual allocation standards, and then we will go by that. We will try to be as flexible as we can, and based on our experience, actually we can exercise flexibility, and we may be giving them more than what they want.
I understand they want bigger units, but once they relocate, their living conditions will improve. So you have no solution aside from flexible relocation. So in the future, they might become labeled as spacious, and they might need to relocate again. So you have no solution. Well, as far as I know, that it's either in allocation or design. You understand that Pakting works have already been undergone for quite some time, and we are not just targeting Pakting. I mentioned Suichino and other projects in Hong Kong. We're applying the same principle. We're not targeting Pakting, and we cannot change these principles because of Pakting. Okay. I said that we would like the director to respond in writing to the questions raised. He also will provide an information letter. So we'll conclude this item and move on to the next. Next item is refinancing of premium not paid HOS. We have the paper CB1-1037/1415-03, CB1-1037/1415-04, and CB1-910/1415-01, and CB1-960/1415-01. So let's have the officials enter, and they can take us through the document. Our colleagues are familiar with this issue. So very simply, we have recently in two Q&A sessions responded to this. So I just want to reiterate a couple of points. HOS has alienation restrictions. So if the premiums have not been paid, if they want to seek refinancing, either they pay the premium or they have approval from the housing director. So if they do not pay premium, or if they cannot get approval from the director and seek illegal refinancing, and according to the housing ordinance, this is void. So the people involved, whether they're the owners or people providing the financing, they will have a criminal breach and they are subject to penalty. We had conducted prosecution before in recent years. We've also looked at our vetting procedures. We have simplified the procedures where possible. And in successful prosecution, we had produced a press release to remind the public that the alienation restrictions and refinancing conditions. So let me cover these first and see if members have any questions. Well, we already have a few members who've have questions, 王国兴、王玉敏、梁耀忠、梁国雄、冯剑基、郭伟强 and 胡志伟、张 Fernando Zhang. Well, I'll give you 3 minutes because we have another agenda item. 3 minutes, including Q&A. Mr. 王国兴 thank you, Chairman. Well, the ordinance is in front of us. If the refinancing has not been approved by the director, then it's illegal. But in the past 6 years, there have been reports saying that there have been 8,300 subsidized units where they have sought financing from financial institutions, the interest rate being 20-40%. So evidently, the fact tells us that there is a large loophole. Why can intermediaries, lending companies, they blatantly, illegally provide financing? And these owners, they either don't understand or they knowingly, they might have financial hardship and conduct this financing under a lot of risk. So the government, your publicity and education is insufficient, and you also have lax prosecution that leads to this current situation as dire consequences. So what remedial plans do you have? Well, regarding law enforcement, first of all, I need to point out that not every HOS that seeks refinancing will necessarily breach the law. The premium has to be unpaid and they seek refinancing. That will break the law. So that's why our prosecution team in the Housing Authority, they have to look at each case. There has to be sufficient evidence and criminal acts. In the last year, we had 27 prosecutions and 11 were successfully prosecuted. Another 11 are still being dealt with. And when we submit prosecution cases, the courts will have a different view. And so it doesn't mean that each case will necessarily be convicted. You have to look at each case individually. Well, will you liaise with the Monetary Authority and other agencies, law enforcement agencies? Will you conduct an investigation of these financial institutions? Well, Housing Authority, we are not given the power to, we cannot penalize these financial institutions. Well, we are in constant liaison with the authorities. So regarding financial institutions and intermediaries, we need to work with the Financial Service and Treasury Bureau. So whether it's the Monetary Authority or Investment Education Center, we have a publicity and awareness programs. Well, I would like an intra-departmental effort on targeting this. Well, the paper talks about the vetting of financing approval and also law enforcement in the last 5 years. The approvals were some 1,100. The rest were illegal. So if you just look at the law enforcement figures, the authorities have not taken it seriously. In the last year, there were only 27 prosecution cases of a breach of 27A of the housing ordinance. 11 cases are still undergoing. So why do we have such low conviction figures? It's definitely lax enforcement. You have not plugged the loophole, so it's hard to shirk your responsibility. Now, you're saying that not all financing applications are legal. It's just that those that have not paid the premium and sought refinancing, that would only be a breach of 27A. So even if they use HOS as collateral and have not paid the premium. Well, some financial institutions, they provide personal loans, and they are able to circumvent the law. Just now you answered Wang Guangheng and you said it's not your business, you can't handle it. And Mr. Wang Guangheng called for intra-departmental effort. Well, the finance companies are not regulated by the monetary authority, even though we have the Money Lenders Ordinance. The police, between 2012 and 2014, there have only been 44 prosecution cases against money lenders and financial institutions. Only 23 were successful. So that is a problem as well. You'll say that it's not your business. But all these are related. You're not coming up with a solution to these problems. You're just saying that you're giving us you're giving us a standard response, but the fact is a lot of people are breaking the law. Just the HOS sale and purchase agreement and the financing agreement, well, this is going against the subsidized housing principle. So it's pointless in discussing this. We have refinancing of HOS with premium unpaid. What the message you're giving us is you're just talking about the HOS ordinance. Okay, Leung Yuzhong, and then Leung Guohong. I agree with a lot of what Mr. Wang Yuman said. The government departments are turning a blind eye to this. Their attitude is that they're not going to be bothered. Why do I say that? The complaints division has received a lot of these cases. We have handed the housing department these pamphlets. The finance companies say it doesn't matter if you have not paid the premium, they can still get a loan. But there are no government departments following up. They allow them to exist. And that leads to people with financial needs, they will take these risks. But this is your responsibility. You know of these scenarios, but you turn a blind eye. We're telling this to the housing department. The housing department says it's not their business. Well, we need to target the finance company's illegal behavior, where they tempt or encourage these people to take out loans. If public awareness and education were sufficient, then we wouldn't have these problems. It's just not working. When people need money, what help does publicity and education provide? When they are not aware and they are tempted by these pamphlets, they will go out and seek a loan. In the past, have you received these pamphlets? What have you done after you received these pamphlets? Ms. Wong, let me clarify. The questions you raise, it's not something that can be dealt with the HOS ordinance. 17B of the housing ordinance says that if these illegal refinancing are void, so this safeguards the HOS as being a subsidized housing. So what they have done in previously doesn't matter. We have safeguards. Well, we also need other ordinances to deal with this, but from the awareness point of view, when the owner purchases HOS, it's stated very clearly that there are alienation restrictions. So when we work with the Monetary Authority, the Investment Education Center, the Consumer Council, owners have their responsibility to deal with their own finances. HOS is not an investment tool. So when they have emergency needs, they need refinancing, we have channels for doing so, and the channels are very clear. Now, is there anything else that can be done to improve? We will look at it. But if you look at the HOS ordinance, there have to be breaches before we can use the HOS ordinance. Not all refinancing applications breach these ordinances. Well, they have not answered the question, have you received these pamphlets? Mr. Leung, he has provided us with old pamphlets. But you have to look at the wording of the pamphlet. These are legal questions. The wording has not touched on the HOS used as collateral for refinancing with the premium unpaid. So not all HOS refinancing cases are a breach of the law. Mr. Leung Kok Hong and then Fong Kim Kei. Well, we don't need to don't need to raise such a big fuss. Well, the market has people who want to purchase HOS, people want to apply through the white form. The profit cannot be made. If they want to pay the premium, it's for a profit. Nobody would pay the premium if there was a loss. So you just need to copy Singapore. You just need to take the HOS and regulate the market. Don't allow them to sell. Then how can the financial institutions benefit from that? You cannot just ask the government to take a look and investigate financial institutions. The banks won't, do you understand what I'm saying? They won't touch these cases. So HOS market has to be established in Hong Kong, where when you have a subsidy, you cannot benefit from that. If you want to move out, you have to give it the person on a white or green form.
So let's do a reform like that, but you won't do it. Second, about the intermediaries. They may be related to HOS or may not be related to HOS flats. Because prices of HOS flats rise up, and so they can't, these intermediaries can benefit. And also the HOS flat owners would also like to gain. So that's why they get cheated by the intermediaries. So you speak half the truth only. So the policy can be very simple, and that is try to regulate the market. Once you've received a subsidy, then you can't make a profit out of your subsidized property. I think for the intermediaries, they should be brought under regulation by the HKMA. Mr. Leung Kwok Hong, I must criticize you. I can share with you a lot of cases, and well, actually, many of the cases have to do with the intermediaries. When I speak, I will try to explain why the intermediaries are involved. Well, just look at Singapore. Well, the flat owners can only sell the flats to those in need. And then the government acts as the intermediary. So we can resolve the problem with the intermediaries. That's my point. So if there are other problems related to intermediaries, then they have to be dealt with in other ways. The government can act as the intermediary itself. After the meeting, I can provide you with more information on to demonstrate how serious the problem is. Dr. Fernando Zhang, Madam Chair, the question is rather simple. There are restrictions on transfer of HOS flats. Premium has to be paid. And if refinancing has to be done, the housing department's approval has to be sought. Now, there are 7,000 HOS flats which have been refinanced, and only 1,700 have got the approval from the housing department. And most of them, it shows that they are doing refinancing illegally. And in the that their loan agreement has to be registered with the land's registry. And in the land registry, there is this loan agreement registered, and there are two things set out. And before the approval of the finance companies or before the premium is paid, then there should not be refinancing. And the second condition is that the finance companies would have to get the loan repaid first before the money is returned to the flat owners. Government, is it the case that the lands registry is assisting people in registering certain illegal documents? Ms. Wong, I can only speak based on the information I have. Lands registry for instruments affecting land leases, well, all these documents have to be registered. The aim is that we should prevent any secret deals. And also, we can try to identify the titles as accurately as possible. So that's according to the Land Registration Ordinance, such documents have to be registered. For anything registered under the lands registry, in the land registry, it doesn't mean that the documents are necessarily legally sound. Now, so for any instrument which has been registered with the lands registry and which has to do with refinancing of HOS flats with premium unpaid, it doesn't mean that they are legal. You know that this is illegal. Why don't you do something? Talk to the lands registry. Whenever there are these documents, well, can they refuse them to be registered? For our colleagues initiating prosecution, they will have to look at the exact wordings on the documents to see if the documents are legal or void. And actually, if we take reference from both ordinances, then we will be able to identify illegal behavior. We may take our prosecution, we may succeed or not succeed in our prosecution. This has to do with legal points, and we have to study each and every case. These contracts are illegal, and the problem now is that these financial institutions are tempting or asking these HOS flat owners to do such illegal acts, and it's not right that you turn a blind eye to it. It's now my turn. Mr. Lang Kwok Hong, you don't seem to understand the situation. HOS flat owners, if they want to get refinancing, they have to get the approval from the housing department. Sometimes the process can take as long as 10 months. And during that period, the financial intermediaries will tell them that, well, we can't lend the money to you now, and you don't have to wait that long. Now, why is it the housing department takes 10 months to give the approval, and as a result, these HOS flat owners are turning to the financial institutions to take out a loan. And also, secondly, Dr. Zhang, Fernando Zhang, said that for many of these loan agreements, the loan borrowers couldn't actually return the loan, and so that there was, they end up with an encumbrance on their land leases. So, Deputy Director, have you taken a look at how many land leases which have been have an encumbrance because of this, and how many of them have to do with illegal refinancing? Some financial companies are taking advantage of the loopholes in the law, and they said that it is refinance. Well, they use the personal loans and try to circumvent the law. Have you taken any measures to prevent such financial intermediaries to do so? And Madam Chair, you talk about 10 months for us to process the applications. And starting from 1st of June, we have further streamlined the procedures. In the past, the applicants might not be clear about what documents were required and so on. And starting from the 1st of June, we have further streamlined the procedures. We have given out a checklist of documents required to be furnished. We want to shorten the time. But of course, each case differs. There may be cases where further documents have to be submitted, so that may take longer. In the past 5 years, we have reviewed 4,500 records. And if we suspect there was foul play in certain records, we would follow up duly and may even take prosecution action. But it's not the case that every loan agreement will be in breach of the housing ordinance. I have three questions. Have you referred information on financial intermediaries to other relevant government departments so that for example, the police and also the company's registry and so on, so that the licenses, the renewal applications of for the licenses of these intermediaries will be refused. In a recent case, we issued a press release to publicize the case. So we would also like to let the public know that they learn about the problems in a certain case. Ms. Wong, I don't think it has to do with the public only. Say, if a company's registry has to decide on whether a moneylender's license can be renewed, it has to take on board the acts that they have engaged in. Now, if you don't submit the relevant information to them, then the company's registry will still renew their license and they can go on cheating people. I understand that to resolve the problem, it involves other government departments as well. But please note that the situation is very rampant these days. And actual ads flat owners who may be cheated, well, they may be under financial difficulties, and that will become a big social problem in the future if you don't do anything. So can you take a more proactive approach? Can you proactively look into the records in the land registry? How many land titles, where there has been an encumbrance on the land titles? You said that you have checked more than 4,500 land search records annually. Have you particularly looked at the points that I mentioned? Have you referred information that you have to say to the police and the company's registry so that they can take follow-up action accordingly? Madam Chair, I can provide you with the information after the meeting. We don't. We are now not looking at the land search records in the lands registry for encumbrance on land titles. There are now 380,000 HO flats with premium unpaid. And we question whether it is cost-effective to look in each and every HOS flat, the case of each. Can you discuss with the Lands Registry if there are cases where there is an encumbrance on the land titles of HOS flats with premium unpaid? Can they notify you if such is found? Well, we have to see whether it is a cost-effective way of using public funds, because Lands Registry has to incur costs if they are going to do that. So we have to try to see what is the most cost-effective approach to take. So can you give us a reply later on after you have considered it? For every unit, there is a setup cost, $200, and for every alert, extra charge will be levied. Now, we have 380,000 HOS flats, so we have to be very careful in the use of public funds. And every year, we check more than 4,500 land search records every year. So this is quite a sum. Can we do better? We can consider. Nevertheless, we have to consider the cost effectiveness of anything we do. I'm not a member of this panel, but I am very concerned about this issue.
Regarding the cost effectiveness, but when PRHHOS is sold, the beneficiary of the first mortgage, of course, you are consider whether the interests are diluted. If it is the bank, they would definitely take action. They wouldn't take a protected asset and see it diminished. So your assets have to be used this way. But more importantly, you need to provide an incentive for unscrupulous financial institutions. I see that in your document that in order to enhance application efficiency, you've relaxed it. So you've turned a blind eye to this. Initially, it might be out of good intentions. But now you've allowed the wolves into the flock of sheep, so you need to tighten up the situation. I don't fully understand why that in the mortgage documents they do not mention a second mortgage. So do you mean that as long as lawyers and financial institutions, as long as they are alert and do not mention the second mortgage, but for the applicant, you're asking them to submit the relevant documents, and that you would apply a charge or encumbrance. So sometimes we don't need to talk about these things on the document. You can just have a verbal agreement when they person wants to mortgage his property, the lawyers or financial institution might just tell them to bring the mortgage papers along. Well, I just want to tell you that there is this loophole and you need to plug the loophole. I'd like to respond to the first question that the housing authority, have their interests been diluted? That's not the case, because under 17B of the housing ordinance, for these illegal refinancing, it's void. No matter what they do, ultimately it's void. It could even be a criminal offense. So the financial institutions or intermediaries, whether the behavior is fraudulent, this cannot be handled by the housing ordinance. Well, the government knowingly knows that people conduct these behavior. You are just condoning this behavior. there is a risk. Is the government going to bear the risk? We have conducted a prosecution. When we succeed, we have also press release notifying the public. Can Mrs. Ho respond to the second question? Responding to Mr. Chie's question, we want to simplify the vetting procedure, the application procedure. So if we want to if we can simplify it and apply our standard template, we can safeguard the first mortgage. We can simplify the whole procedure. I understand, but when you simplify the procedure, you created loopholes. You've allowed people to omit the term and apply a second charge. Well, we want the first mortgage to be recovered, but the second mortgage, they have to be responsible for that. Mr. Fong Kim-kei. Okay. Well, all our questions have been answered, and I asked Ms. Wong to submit the relevant documents. The last agenda item, enforcement actions against subdivided units in industrial buildings and support services for affected tenants. We have two documents, CB1-1037/1415-05 and CB1-1037/1415-06. So, could you take us through the paper? Regarding subdivided units in industrial buildings, I don't need to reiterate that industrial buildings are not for residential uses. There are potential hazards. So the government has stated clearly that that they would enforce the law. So these problems don't arise out of the law enforcement day. There has been time where the affected tenants have been made aware of this law enforcement. The social workers might help them, but ultimately there are still some people who end up homeless. So the housing department will have a transit center to help them settle temporarily. Whether we have a interim housing plan, we have mentioned in numerous occasions that we will build PRH if we have some land available. So a interim housing would be difficult. So it's now here from legislators. Well, I will extend the meeting to 4:45. We have Wong Kok-hing, Fong Kim-kei, Wong Yuk-man, Leung Kok-hong, and Zheng Qiu-hong. Wong Kok-hing, 3 minutes. Chairman, I'd like to ask the authorities, those people living in industrial buildings, those living in subdivided units, of course, this is a housing supply insufficiency that leads to this outcome. Well, the question is, the industrial building owners, the owners, they are obviously breaking the law. So I want to ask, have they been prosecuted? Because when we need to relocate, we need to settle these people, resources have to be spent. But owners have collected rent. They don't bear any responsibility. So I think the crux of the matter is that the government has allowed industrial buildings to be subdivided, and they have not prosecuted the owners. Well, let's hear from Mr. Zheng of the Housing Department, of the Buildings Department. SDUs and industrial buildings, if we identify these cases, we will issue them letters telling them to remove the partitions, and if they don't heed our warning, we'll prosecute them, and the maximum penalty of is 200,000, and we have prosecuted these cases. Well, how many successful prosecutions have you had? Why do we have rental of SDUs in industrial buildings? It indicates that your prosecution efficiency is very low. How can they subdivide and let the premises and you cannot prosecute? As I said just now, we do have prosecutions, and the courts have already levied a penalty. Why can they continue to rent the SDUs? Is your prosecution efficiency very low? After our first successful prosecution, if they still do not comply, we will issue the second prosecution. How long is it before the second? We had prosecution within a year, second prosecution within a year. So these industrial building owners, do they consider it as cost of rental because of the efficiency is so low, you encourage them to break the law? I mentioned that under the law, if they are convicted, the maximum penalty is 200,000, and for every day they do not comply with the warning, they can have a fine of 20,000, and they can also be imprisoned. Well, we see that there's no deterrent effect. If there were a deterrent effect, the industrial building owners would not subdivide the units. Chairman, it's obvious that Hong Kong doesn't have enough housing. That's why industrial buildings are being subdivided. And we've seen a TV program where this occurs. So, and second, you allow relocation, resettlement in the Tuen Mun Transit Center. It's feasible for one person, but you can't have a whole family. If they are homeless, they should be given a unit. And why do you assign to Tuen Mun, whereas Satley has 80% vacancy? Third, the government had also considered revitalizing industrial building and converting into temporary housing. The major hazard is fire hazard. The government can revitalize industrial buildings. If there are no windows, you can provide exemptions. In the past, we had squatter housing, where that was tolerated for decades. Now, Hong Kong has a serious shortage of housing, and we have some only stopgap measures. There's no land. We have a plot in Homantin that has been vacant for 10 years. Why can't that be used as temporary housing? We can take land that has not been used for temporary housing. We also have redevelopment areas. We have Bak Tin. We now have some 2,000 odd units that are vacant for 2 years. Urban redevelopment, private redevelopment. Why that can be used as temporary housing, especially for those on the waiting list for 3 years. They can be relocated to PRH. We have resources. We cannot wait 5 years for the housing to be created. we have some vacant land. Mr. From Kimke keeps talking about this. We have GIC land. This is being reviewed regularly. It has also been reserved for public housing. For example, in the Kuntong and Chumun area too. We also have procedures in place for rezoning, so we won't waste the land. Well, I can't turn back the clock, but now we are looking at it very aggressively. We're looking at it proactively. Well, can we revitalize industrial buildings? We just need to comply with the fire hazard. Well, you can follow up in the second round, Mr. Wong Yuan. Well, our agenda item is enforcement against enforcement actions against subdivided units in industrial buildings and support services for affected tenants. So there are actually three issues. They are related and also mutually contradictory. The housing department said that this is necessary. So you cannot enforce the law very vigorously. The temporary measures or interim measures are very poor. So we have a contradiction. If you look at the topic, there are three related topics, but mutually contradictory. So you don't want to enforce the law. So I won't even talk about law enforcement. I'm just concerned about support services. Starting from October 2012 up to April 2015, we have 3.5 years. The only 205 people were settled, and we have more than 100,000 people living in subdivided units, and only 0.2% of SDU tenants are benefited from the support services.
So these figures are unsatisfactory. So the relocation allowance is only $2,000, and well, the monthly car park underlink rent costs $3,000. So $2,000, how can that be an effective support? 2 years ago, we erected some tents outside the Pioneer Center in Mong Kok, and these are staged by people chased out of the SDUs in industrial buildings. Well, they pay, say, that $1,000 a month for the rent, but they can't pay the rent out of the CSSA they receive. If they have to rent a private flat, they have to pay a deposit, they have to pay several $1,000s a month in rent, so they need rehousing. $2,000 is of no use at all. The SDU environment is deteriorating as well. This is a disgrace to Hong Kong. Hong Kong is a very sophisticated city. We are sitting on a 800,000 billion dollar reserve, and in Kuntong, well, a flat is just above a toilet, a cock loft. Well, and that cost $2,000 a month in rental. Have you visited the place? No, I'm sure you haven't. Well, you are just like a cold machinery. You are just quoting some laws in your reply. You haven't been able to resolve the problem. So that's all I want to say. It's a waste of my time. Any response? On many occasions, we said that we have to depend on PRH to to address the housing problem. But we can't provide PRH overnight, and we can't provide PRH only a lot of PRH in urban areas. And I know that a lot of SDU tenants have to work in urban areas. Well, I mean, they can have themselves only to blame are these SDU tenants. They are poor. And you said that it would be unfair if PRH flats are allocated to SDU tenants. It would be unfair to those on the PRH those on the PRH waiting list. Mr. Lam Kwok Hong, I think you have got the issues wrong with in relation to SDU units. It doesn't have anything to do with unauthorized building works. It's a problem with inadequate supply of housing. So you have got the wrong concept. You deal with parallel traders. You treat them as travelers and not a transient population. The same applies here. We've got inadequate housing, so people are forced to live in undesirable or dangerous housing. This is not a problem of illegal structure. This is a housing issue. So you can't tackle it from the perspective of illegal structure. This is not a problem of illegal structure. This is a problem of inadequate housing. And because you are taking that perspective, so you are not trying to solve the problem at root, i.e. providing adequate housing to those displaced. I'm about to turn 60. I've witnessed the development of temporary housing in Hong Kong. And also improved or enhanced temporary housing with the help of the government. The CE said that housing is an issue in Hong Kong. Can't he turn vacant sites into temporary housing? In Kuaishing Court, well, back then, there was a rodents are biting this child. Well, there was no housing for these people, so they had to put up with this kind of situation. You shouldn't be tackling the problem from the perspective of eradicating illegal structures. Some 100,000 people are living in SDUs. It's going to be a big problem. Well, you may be seeing people actually committing suicide because of the problems they face. I know that you are a civil servant. I hope that you can reflect to your senior level. Please take a more people-oriented approach. I should be talking to the deputy secretary. Who is the deputy secretary? What bureau are you talking about? The undersecretary. Oh. Yao Xingmo is the Undersecretary. Why isn't he here today? We are talking about policy. I'm not trying to offend you, Ms. Wong, but I must just say what I want to say. Next one, Dr. Fernando Zheng. Short question and short answer, please. I know that this enforcement action is aimed at 98 industrial buildings. You said that you have worked on 51, so there are some 40 outstanding, around half of them remaining. How many residents have been affected? That's number one. Second, how many of them have moved to other SDUs? Do you have any figures? So perhaps Mr. Zhang from the Buildings Department can take that question. We don't have the information or statistics on hand. We don't know where have these tenants moved. Well, you don't care about where they have moved to after the enforcement action. We can't require them to give us the information. Well, that's the crux of the problem, Madam Chair. They don't see the residents. They just, all they can see are the bricks. Because in your policy, you are not dealing with the people. And you only said that if they have nowhere to turn to, then they will be housed in the transit center. Well, you demolished the temporary housing in the 90s, and you built interim housing. Now you have the transit center. You either go to Poutine or Shek Lei for the Wing Fung industrial building incident. Well, not even Shek Lei transit center will accommodate those affected. There is a vacancy rate of 60% in Shek Li Transit Center. Transit center is just like the home for the sleepless. If they are not singles, they have a family, then well, they would not like to move into such a transit center. But you seem to be turning a blind eye to all these. So as a result, given the $2,000 relocation subsidy given to them, they would not be able to pay the monthly rent and the deposit for renting another flat. You seem to be using an anti-riot squad to do the enforcement, and they're not even allowed to take or clear away their belongings, personal belongings. So you were treating them like rioters. Are you targeting the owners or are you targeting the tenants here? You said that you would prosecute the owners, you would be imposing a fine of $200,000. For Wing Fong owner, well, it is fined only $20,000. Well, they can easily pay that out of the rental they receive. So are you clamping down on the owners or the tenants? Who to respond? Perhaps defer to Mr. Zhang from the Buildings Department. As I said in the beginning, actually, before enforcement action was taken, the Buildings Department had gave notice in advance, and there is a team to help those affected as well. Mr. Zhang.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Let me provide you with further information. Dr. Zhang referred to the prosecution of Wing Fong. We took out two prosecutions against the owner. In the first prosecution, the two owners were fined $20,000. In the second prosecution, $40,000 in fine was imposed. And for the second owner, there was a delayed sentencing. We don't know ultimately what the fine will be. It's almost at 4:45, and if Frederick Fung would like to ask for a second round, can I be allowed to extend the meeting time till 5 p.m.? No objection? No? All right, okay. Mr. Yu, is it the case you want to respond? I'd like to supplement a bit here. Ms. Wong from the Housing Department said that in the patrolling actions of Buildings Department, if SDUs are identified in industrial buildings, we would be liaising with the residents. And there is a social service team within the Buildings Department to liaise or approach the tenants. If they meet with the compassionate housing requirements, BRH housing requirements, they would be working together with the Housing Department and try to do a referral and help the tenants. If Buildings Department is to issue a closure order, adequate notice will be given to the tenants. We will talk to the tenants individually so that they can make their own arrangements. In the enforcement action taken by the Buildings Department, we would accord the priority to public safety. Industrial buildings are not suitable for people to live in. If there is domestic use within industrial buildings, stringent enforcement actions have to be undertaken. I hope that you can understand this. For this Wing Fong industrial building, was it the case that your social workers actually approached each and every tenant in that building? Mr. Zhang, do you have such information? In November 2014, we posted notices saying that we are applying for a closure order, and we told them that we would apply for a closure order in March 2015. And in that period, the social service team of the Buildings Department actually visited the tenants and see what assistance we could offer. We also liaised with HAD, SWT, and HD, and we tried to provide help to the tenants. After the meeting, could you provide us with a paper setting out the measures you have taken in relation to the closure order of Wing Feng Industrial Building? Mr. Frederick Feng, 3 minutes. Please answer the three questions I raised. I think we can revitalize industrial buildings. Do you know that actually there are 60 feet flats accommodating 4 persons. Do you think these are kind of spaces suitable for people to live in? So I still think that industrial buildings can be revitalized for domestic uses. Maybe people can stay there for 3 years. And also, Shek Li, there are 1,100 units vacant. How come that you are not accommodating people in these flats and asking them to go to Tuen Mun? And also the vacant flats in redevelopment projects, for example, Shek Kip Mei and so on, can they be used to accommodate these displaced tenants? Revitalization of industrial buildings. We conducted a study earlier, and in July 2013, we submitted a paper to the Subsidized Housing Committee under the Long-Term Housing Strategy Committee, and we explained that actually we talked to the industrial building owners. If the conversion was to be made, it would be very costly, and sometimes it will also be technically difficult or infeasible. We don't think this is a feasible option. In some industrial areas, the government is trying to identify land plots in these areas to build residential housing.
The transit center, we only have Boutin and Dao, the sector is interim housing, and we have regulations for interim housing. They have to be eligible for PRH. If they're still on the waiting list, they have to have PRH eligibility in order to enter the interim housing. If they go to Boutin and they stay there for 3 months and they qualify as a homeless, and if they are deemed that they can qualify for PRH, their assets are within the limits, they can queue in the PRH waiting list, and they can also be settled in the interim housing. So not all people with temporary housing can qualify. So this is something that we feel that we need to be very strict. I'm not familiar with the individual projects, but when we redevelop, when we allow the estate tenants to relocate, we want to start redevelopment as soon as possible. If we allow temporary tenants, then the whole project will be delayed, and they need to relocate in a short period of time twice. That's not suitable as well, Mr. Leung Kohong. Well, I feel it's a matter of policy. We have a lot of housing that is converted into hotels. If you walk along Devoe Road, Queens Road Central, Connaught, you can see how many are commercial, residential, and it's converted to hotels. We have a lot of hotels in Hong Kong. Now, if you have a policy where we can resolve the problem of people living in industrial buildings, so Carrie Lam and Paul Chan's failure, they had said they can only provide 10,000. They can't do anything beyond that. Well, can't you look into the issue deeper? The industry, the owners feel it's a waste of time. Otherwise, when you don't have a backup plan, you just demolish the unauthorized building works, you're just falling deeper into hell. To use the Wingfeng as an example, the whole Qunwan SDU prices have gone up. You are now demolishing the SDUs. Do you understand? There's no place for them to relocate. They were in the seventh level of hell, and now you've pushed them deeper in hell. I understand you have a responsibility to deal with unauthorized building works, whether it's a SDU or not. But if you don't follow up, if you just deal with the problem at hand, then... So I don't blame you. If you continue, I have a plan that deals with unauthorized building works, especially industrial buildings. As Ms. Wong said, can interim housing be used to accommodate these people? I understand interim housing. It's just the same as temporary housing. But can you change? Can you do something about it? Your policy now is to make people homeless. They're in the 17th level of hell, now they're going... the policy should be, we're trying to avoid people entering the 17th level. I won't elaborate anymore. If the issue explodes in front of you, you'll just say that legislators did not monitor the issue. Well, we've cleared out 51 buildings. How many tenants were affected? Just now you mentioned that there could be compassionate rehousing. We don't have these figures. The SWD should have these figures. And Mr. Fung, SWD doesn't have a figure. So it's just empty talk. They have nobody following affected tenants. So we have a policy that deals with SDUs in industrial buildings. You have social workers to follow up, and then ultimately you send in the mob police. You send them off to Tuen Mun Transit Center. Secondly, has a 60% interim housing vacancy. You don't. Yeah, urban development UDA has a 60% vacancy. You don't allow that. You just walk in and clear out the SDU, and you move on to the next industrial building. So is that the way to go forward? You've done your job. You can answer to the public. We've cleared out SDUs and industrial buildings. We won't allow Hong Kong residents to live in hazardous industrial buildings. Is that what you do? Well, you've cleared out 51 SDUs in industrial buildings, and you can't tell us how many tenants were affected. How many families benefited from compassionate rehousing? You don't have figures for that. So where is your conscience? The people, the most disadvantaged, the people that have to live in SDUs in industrial buildings. These are the roots of the grassroots. You don't consider people's needs. In the past, you cleared out squatter housing, you created temporary housing. When you cleared out caged housing, you had a singleton housing that was run by NGOs. We still have two centers. You know there is a need. You have done that in the past. Well, of course, that wasn't the SAR. It was the colonial government. But the officials were the same. Why don't you do something now? I'd like to ask Mr. Cheung, you say that the social workers have done so much work, but as Mr. Fernando Cheung asked, how many families were affected and ultimately where have they settled? So when you just have the bailiffs issue the eviction notice and you don't follow up? Well, Chairman, we have social workers and they provide different opinions. They help them find singleton housing or they help them seek welfare. Also, we don't have the information. And some individual owners assist the tenants to relocate. They relocate to other SDUs. Well, some owners, after you've evicted the SDU tenants, their deposits were not returned, and you say there are social workers following up, but the tenants weren't able to collect the deposits. There's no follow up. The social worker, we don't have the tenants' information. We cannot follow up. The community care fund has a relocation expense. We have figures for that. The document also talked about that. We had 141 households who had sought the community care fund relocation subsidy. How many cases? What's the total number of cases? In our investigation, it's very hard to collect census data. It's only when they apply for the community care fund relocation expense that we know how many households and how many household members. All we know is that there's an SDU, so we just can't collect that information. Well, if you evict, you don't even know how many households, how many people are in there. So are you taking them as objects or people? We're dealing with residents. When we contact them, some do refuse contact. We don't know how many people are living in the SDU. When we contact them, if they respond, then we know how many people are living there. I'd like to ask SWD, the building department, how many cases have been referred to the SWD because of this? If you're referring to Wing Fung Industrial Building, the 14 households had applied to SWD for compassionate rehousing. Our colleagues in the last few months had reviewed each case and we see there were some 14 cases and they do not comply with the compassionate rehousing conditions. Responding to Mr. Fernando Jung's question, the SWD does not have a compassionate rehousing because of industrial building SDUs. We want to provide long-term housing for cases that need long-term housing. It does not depend on what type of housing they're living in to be resettled. So we cannot count certain figures. There might be social factors, medical factors. And we suggest to our buildings department they be resettled. But eviction from SDU is not something we deal with. We've heard the officials, and they are, if you just look at their posts, they are doing a good job. But nobody is looking at it from a human perspective. When you evict SDUs and industrial buildings, that's correct. It's not suitable for housing. SDUs are just not suitable for residential purposes. So what you need to deal with the people affected. So you're ignoring that. You're just achieving your eviction targets. But you should be enhancing living conditions. You don't even know where the people are resettling. And then how they solve their living needs, you totally ignore that. So it's wrong. What are you doing? You're not doing human work. So I hope, Chairman, that this panel should state clearly that you should look at your whole package. You need to assist all the households affected by evicting SDUs in industrial buildings. So in this eviction process and after the eviction process, what arrangements have there been? How can you enhance their living conditions? If you remove them from a hazardous condition to an even more hazardous condition, then your whole action was a failure. I'd like the government officials to look into this, because there's going to be a continuous eviction of SDUs in industrial buildings. There is going to be a lot of dissatisfaction if you don't handle this properly. Okay, our meeting will end here. We don't have any AOB. Thank you very much.
Hiya.